In this video tutorial, I am going to discuss about aerobic and anaerobic glycolysis. In the earlier video of this playlist, I had already discussed about all the reactions of glycolysis. In that video, we had seen that glucose first undergo multi-step reaction to give rise to fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. This fructose 1,6-bisphosphate gets splitted into 2-3 carbon compound. One is dihydroxyacetone phosphate and second one is glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. This dihydroxyacetone phosphate and glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate both are interconvertible, right? So that means each glucose molecule has a potential to give rise to 2 glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate. So this occurs 2 times, right? This glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate then first converted into 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate. This 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate undergoes multi-step reaction and ultimately gives rise to pyruvate, right? So this is the entire pathway of the glycolysis and this occurs in the cytoplasm. Now what happens when we discuss about aerobic and anaerobic glycolysis? The step which converts glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate, this step is very, very important. Why? The reason is that during that step, NAD plus is reduced to the NADH plus H plus, right? Now, why this step is important during discussion of aerobic and anaerobic glycolysis? The reason is that the concentration of glucose in the cytoplasm is very, very high as compared to the concentration of NAD plus in the cytoplasm. If we actually speak about the number, in the cytoplasm, the glucose concentration is approximately 10^-3 molar, that is moles per liter, whereas the concentration of NAD plus in the cytoplasm is approximately 10^-5 molar, right? So here we can see that NAD plus concentration is 100 times lesser than the concentration of glucose. So what will happen? There will be, in the few minutes of glycolysis, all the NAD plus will get utilized. Once all the NAD plus is utilized, no more glucose can undergo glycolysis. Glycolysis will stop, right? So there is a necessity that this NADH plus H plus should be reoxidized to NAD plus if glycolysis needs to be continued. And nature had designed our body in such a beautiful way that this NADH plus H plus can be reoxidized to NAD plus by two different mechanisms. Let's talk about the first mechanism. So the first, if we talk about the first mechanism, NADH is reoxidized to NAD plus by the electron transport chain. This electron transport chain is located in mitochondria. What this electron transport chain does, it takes up the oxygen, which binds with these two hydrogen molecules and gives rise to water molecule. So just to balance out this reaction, I am just writing 1/2 O2. So here oxygen is getting utilized, right? And by utilizing the oxygen, NAD plus is getting regenerated. So now it will be possible that such a low concentration of NAD plus, now it can keep glycolysis going on and on, right? Now this electron transport chain, what it does is simultaneously it also generates ATPs. That process is known as oxidative phosphorylation. So whenever NAD plus is regenerated by this electron transport chain by utilizing oxygen, we call it as aerobic glycolysis. Aerobic glycolysis, right? So let's first enlist the important aspect of aerobic glycolysis. So what is the absolute requirement for the aerobic glycolysis? So oxygen is the absolute requirement. Oxygen must be there. And along with the oxygen, mitochondria are also required. Why? Because if mitochondria is not there, electron transport will not be there. So oxygen plus mitochondria, both are required, right? Now this process is the slow process. This type of reoxidation of NAD plus is the slow process. So because of this process is slow, entire glycolysis will become a slow. And hence, this aerobic glycolysis, it is also known as slow glycolysis. Slow glycolysis. Then the pyruvate is the end product of the aerobic glycolysis. So here, pyruvate will become end product. This type of aerobic glycolysis, it occurs in the most tissues of human cells. If we talk about anaerobic glycolysis, suppose oxygen is absent. So what will happen? This NADH cannot be reoxidized to NAD plus by this method. So there is a separate mechanism available for the conversion, for this reoxidation to the NAD plus. What is that separate mechanism? So in that mechanism, pyruvate gets converted into the lactate. Here enzyme lactate dehydrogenase is used, and this reaction, what it does is it converts NADH plus H plus to the NAD plus. So here you can see that NAD plus is regenerated, which will be again utilized by this step. Okay, so this mechanism is occurring in the absence of oxygen, right? So let's talk about the silent points of the anaerobic glycolysis. Anaerobic glycolysis. So the first thing is that if this occurs in the absence of oxygen, so if O2 is absent, this mechanism will occur. If only mitochondria is absent, then only this mechanism will occur. So either O2 is absent or mitochondria are absent or both are absent, then this mechanism will occur for the reoxidation of NAD+. The second is that this step, this reaction, or this way of regeneration of NAD+, it is the fast. It is very speedy process. So because of that, anaerobic glycolysis is also known as a fast glycolysis. Fast glycolysis. Then here we can see that lactate is the end product. So lactate becomes end product. Now, which type of tissue will carry out this anaerobic glycolysis? So as I had already told you, whenever there is an absence or less oxygen will be there, or whenever there is a absence of mitochondria. So let's try to list the tissues which are facing these two problems. So first, if we talk about the absence of mitochondria, then very good example is red blood cells. RBCs don't have mitochondria, right? So as mitochondria are not there, aerobic glycolysis cannot occur. So at that time, only anaerobic glycolysis will occur. What tissues don't have sufficient oxygen supply under physiological conditions? So these are lens, cornea, and renal medulla. This lens, cornea, and renal medulla, even in the normal person or under physiological condition, they don't have enough blood supply, so they have a less oxygen supply. So the predominant glycolytic pathway in such case is the anaerobic glycolysis. Now here one very important tissue is the skeletal muscle. Skeletal muscles. Now skeletal muscles, they have a very rich blood supply, and so they have a very good oxygen supply, right? But what happens when these skeletal muscles, they are under exercise, at that time there is a contraction of skeletal muscle. So during contraction of skeletal muscle, what happens, the blood vessel which is lying between the muscle fiber, it will get squeezed. So during squeezes, blood will leave the muscles, right? So because of that, under exercise condition, the skeletal muscle will not have enough or sufficient oxygen supply. Okay, so exercising skeletal muscle also utilize anaerobic glycolysis. Now, see, here in aerobic glycolysis, we had seen that extra ATPs are generated. Whereas in case of anaerobic glycolysis, there is no any generation of extra ATPs, right? So we can say that aerobic glycolysis has a more ATPs. It can provide more ATPs, right? So more ATPs are being generated by the aerobic glycolysis, but this generation is slow. Whereas in case of anaerobic glycolysis, there is a generation of less ATPs, but these less ATPs are generated by very rapid process, as it is a fast glycolysis, right? Now, in case of anaerobic glycolysis, as we had seen, that end product is the lactate, and skeletal muscle is the biggest producer of the lactate. So what will happen to this lactate? Because lactate cannot be further catabolized in our body, in the human cells, right? Lactate is a high energy substance, but our cell cannot extract energy in the form of ATP from the lactate. So what will happen? This lactate diffuses out into the blood and ultimately reaches into the liver. in the liver hepatic cell, suppose this is the hepatic cell, this lactate is reached. This lactate then gets converted back to pyruvate, and this pyruvate, by the process of gluconeogenesis, it is converted to glucose, and this glucose is again supplied back to the skeletal muscle. So this glucose to lactate and lactate to glucose, this cycle goes on and on during the vigorous exercise. This cycle, it is known as Cori cycle. This Cori cycle was discovered by the Cori brothers, and for that they were awarded Nobel Prize in 1947. Now, one very important aspect about this anaerobic glycolysis is that anaerobic glycolysis is the only process which can generate ATPs even in the absence of oxygen. There is no any other pathway which can generate ATP under absence of oxygen, right? Now, we see that lactate is not something abnormal. Lactate is normally produced by the normal person, right? See, lens, cornea, renal medulla, exercise in skeletal muscle, these all tissues are producing lactate continuously even in the normal person. So normally, if we measure the lactate level in the blood, its normal concentration, the normal concentration of the lactate in blood is the 4 to 15 milligram per deciliter. Now, whenever there is an increased lactate concentration in the blood, we call such condition as a lactic acidosis. So, what is lactic acidosis? Lactic acidosis is a blood lactate concentration more than 15 milligram per deciliter. Now, we had just discussed all the biochemistry and physiology of the lactate. We can easily enlist the etiology of the lactic acidosis. So, when will be there a lactic acidosis? Whenever there is a pathologically higher production of the lactate, that will lead to lactic acidosis. For example, strenuous exercise, this will lead to increased lactate production by the muscle, and it will lead to lactic acidosis. The second cause is respiratory distress. During the respiratory distress, what will happen? There is no enough oxygenation of blood, so tissues cannot get enough oxygen, and there will be a more of the anaerobic glycolysis, which ultimately leads to lactic acidosis. Then there is a shock. The shock is the inadequate perfusion of the tissue, right? So here also there is a less oxygen supply, so more of the lactate will be produced. And one very important aspect is the cancers. Various cancers has a potency to develop a lactic acidosis. Why cancer cells produce lactic acid? See, what is cancer? Cancer is an uncontrolled, abnormal, excessive growth of the cell. Suppose this is the abnormal, excessive growth of the cell. Now, this cancer cell, they require glycolysis for the energy production, right? But what happened? The blood vessel cannot keep up a pace with the growth of this cell. So, these are the blood vessels which cannot grow faster like these cells. So, what will happen? The central part of this cancer tumor, they will experience a less oxygen supply. So, this central mass, they start producing lactate, and so lactic acidosis will be seen. All this condition, they will lead to mild form of lactic acidosis. If we want to enlist the etiology of the severe lactic acidosis, severe lactic acidosis occurs whenever there is a complete collapse of circulatory system. Whenever blood circulation is completely collapsed, at that time we observe a severe form of lactic acidosis. What are the causes of complete collapse of circulatory system? The very important example is the myocardial infarction. In myocardial infarction, heart is affected, right? Heart keeps the blood circulating, but if heart itself is getting failed, then blood will not circulate, and so there will be mass, all the tissue will not get enough of the oxygen. The second cause is the pulmonary embolism. In case of pulmonary embolism, what will happen? Your respiratory system will fail to oxygenate the blood. Then uncontrolled hemorrhage, when so much of the blood is lost and that blood loss is not controlled, at that time there will be a less blood in the circulatory system, which will lead to less oxygen tension and so increase lactic acid production, and whenever there is a severe shock. So these are the etiologies, these are the etiologies of the lactic acidosis, and in all this etiology, one thing is common, that whenever there is a less oxygen, it leads to lactic acidosis. That means lactate level in the blood goes more than 15 milligram per deciliter. So does it mean that if we provide oxygen, this lactic acidosis can come back to the normal within a 4 to 15 milligram per deciliter range? Yes, if we provide oxygen, then this lactic acid can come back to its normal range. So from that, one term is derived, that is oxygen depth. What is oxygen depth? It is the amount of oxygen which is required to remove excess of the lactic acid is called the oxygen depth, right? So again, what is oxygen depth? Oxygen depth is the amount of oxygen required to remove the lactic acid is called the oxygen depth. So that's all about aerobic and anaerobic glycolysis, and along with that, I had also discussed some important aspect of the lactic acidosis and oxygen depth. If you have any query or confusion, please write it down in the comment section below. Thank you.